Ken Duncan, who is a panoramic photographer. Not panoramic in terms of his size, panoramic. Panoramic in terms of the photos he takes. And has just brought this book out, which is spectacular. We'll look at it in more detail later. Ken, good morning.
Good morning, Paul.
You didn't need to dress up.
Mate, I love colour. If you ever get lost in the bush, you've got to be colourful so they can find you.
We'll find you easily today. Let's just talk very quickly about Damien Ryan's photo there, since we've just, you know, Magdalena just talked about it. Now, I was pretty harsh on it. What do you make of it?
Look, great sky, bad foreground. This happens all the time when people show me sunrises and sunsets. They're so obsessed with the sunrise and sunset, they forget to give you a good foreground. So he needs to work on his foreground. Yep. Great cloud.
Yeah, it's a rubbish photo, isn't it, basically?
Well, you can't do much with it. I'm a poor guy.
Is the reason, though, because when you look at something, obviously your brain is focusing your eye on the thing that you're looking at. Whereas when you take a photograph, your brain's focusing your eye on the photograph, so you see all of the stuff that maybe you didn't even notice if you weren't thinking about it.
Well, one of the things with something like that is once you see a photo, you've got to remember you're going to have to convey it back to people. So you need to create the third dimension. So you need good foreground or something working there. Right. That's
now,
what you need.
The great thing about your books is you're not just saying, look at me, I'm a fantastic photographer, better than any other. You're actually giving people tips in all of your books, like this latest one out here. Tips, for instance, on, you know, have a look at this here. All of these, I said panoramic, look at that.
It's a mega
panoramic. It just goes on forever. Did they not make the book big enough? You had to have fold-out pages.
Things get wider all the time, I think so. That one I needed to go wider, so that's what I did.
In terms of giving people tips, first of all, let's talk hardware. You know, does it matter what sort of camera you've got? Can you take a brilliant photograph with a very cheap camera?
Look, it doesn't matter so much about the camera. Yes, it's lovely to have a phase one at 80 megapixels, but whatever. I shoot with a little Lumix, whatever. Just get the shot. That's the most important thing. In fact, often men especially who get very technical are humbled by women who just go click with their little cameras who are more spiritual.
And you hear people say, I don't know how she got that shot, or I don't know how he got that shot. You know, it's stunning. You should see the camera.
Well, she didn't get caught up in technicality. She just captured the moment.
All right. How much of it is the perfect subject?
Well, waiting for the right light. I've worked on shots for years sometimes. So coming back at different times. For me, I don't want to make a shot in Photoshop. I want to, you know, capture it.
Can I just ask you quickly, do you hate Photoshop?
No, look, it's a reality of modern technology, but for me, there's got to be two styles of photography, photorealism and photo illustration. So, because people, when they see a beautiful landscape, often want to know they can go there and see the same thing.
All right, well, we asked you to choose your two favourite photographs and talk us through them now. Let's look at number one.
Well, this one is, you know, creating a third dimension. In other words, beautiful area, mist. As soon as you see mist, but you see how you're getting a third dimension in that with the
so you've
trees
got the
overlapping.
Then the photo takes you into it. I mean, it is a stunning photograph. And how do you achieve that third dimension?
Well, the third dimension here is by having mist. Mist is really good because it diminishing scale straight away, but also overlapping tree trunks. You see how that automatically your eye sees that and goes, hey, I get it. It's third dimension. Now, sometimes people get caught up in that thirds thing. You don't have to be in thirds. It just becomes a balance, or otherwise everything becomes
I was going to talk to you about composition in a moment. Let's look at the next one that you chose. This is the next favourite of yours. Again, it draws you in, doesn't it?
Draws you in. You've got to and that's what creates the wow factor, because often we go and take photos, we get overwhelmed by the scene, and we come back and we go, gee, it was a lot better than that, because we've failed to create or use elements to create that third dimension here.
Yeah, see, here's the issue
higher.
I have with this photograph here, if you don't mind me saying, because I'm obsessive compulsive.
Yeah.
There's a dinghy missing, isn't there, here?
Which one?
There's a dinghy missing, the one that isn't there.
Oh, no, but that's the one.
Well, he's out.
That would have been too balanced.
He's rode it. Yeah, too balanced. All right, talk to me about composition then, because two photos that you've chosen have very much a central theme, don't they? Is that important? Do you say, this is the main thing I want to focus on, it should be in the middle?
No, not necessarily at all. Sometimes you've got to look at a photo out of focus, and some people seem to get that all the time. But you need to look at what's happening balance-wise. Yeah. So don't get so carried away by the rules. In fact, I love breaking the rules as long as it works.
Okay. All right, well, what we're going to do now is just show you, almost at random actually, two photos that viewers have sent in. And these, now we get photos here which are absolute crap, but these ones are not absolute crap, but they're pretty close. So Jeff has sent this one in here. Was it even worth taking that photograph?
Look,
what is that a photo of?
You've got to get out of the car, you know, or get out of work. You know, like, You got to do, look, it's about position where you take the photo. He needs to get out, get away from those poles and do something with that cloud.
I don't actually even know actually what that is a photo of. Do we? I didn't
That's
know we were going
to
show that one, but
lines.
Is it a photo of that house or the road? Or
look, he's been
ridiculous.
Overwhelmed by a cloud. That's about it.
All right, let's have a look at
luck,
another.
You know.
Now, this is interesting because ostensibly there's some quite nice-looking stuff in there, isn't there?
Yes,
but the photo itself just doesn't grab you.
Look, you've got distraction with the lines down the bottom of that fence down there. It's like where it's not coming. If you've got lines, you need to try and bring them out of the corners, if possible, so you create lead-ins. That's very distracting down the bottom there. And also, look, I see that those roses there, and I see that old wagon there, man, I'd be all over that like a fat kid on a Smartie.
So are you saying that essentially there are some things that you, like a fat, what did you say?
Fat kid on a Smartie.
Oh, I like that. I don't quite understand it, but I like it. So would you get in very close on one of those things, so you would feature one of those items and the rest of it would become the backdrop?
It's too complicated. So you need to start looking for a bit of simplicity in that shot. But I look at those roses. They're beautiful. Look at the roses and that beautiful old wheel.
Yeah, so essentially you've got the product there. You just need to handle it differently. Yeah. Biggest mistake that people make? What's the most common mistake?
Probably that one, creating the third dimension. They get overwhelmed by the scene and they don't put enough in the shot to really bring it together. So that's probably one of the biggest ones. The other one would probably be make sure you actually have your camera and...
No, that's interesting, because that is one of your top tips. Make sure your camera is actually with you.
Well, if you don't have it, you know, so that's why when people have big cameras, it can be just such an ordeal. It's much better if you just have it something simple. I always generally carry...
That's so true. Because I have a really elaborate, lovely camera and I can never be bothered taking it anywhere.
You need a PhD camera called a push-here dummy. And I love them.
What do you make of, because almost everyone has a camera with them now, because everyone has their phone with them.
Yep.
I mean, is it a tragedy that people now tend to be quite happy to take photographs on cameras? Photographs on cameras, phones?
Look, the only problem was taking photos on the phone, they leave them on the phone. The saddest thing is you can lose your whole history by just a delete button by accident. So you need to get them off the digital medium and do something, print them. That's the worst tragedy that's happening.
Now, finally, you have one, is a wonderful line of yours, treat your photographs with respect. Now, what do you mean by that?
Well, for me, treating them with respect is you've spent a lot of energy to take them, do something with them, so people can see them. Don't just do this iPad or iPhone, go, well, look at this, and all this. Do something, put them on a wall and people create
celebrate them.
It's your life, your story.
It's one of the problems, there are just too many blooming photos out there, and so you've got to sift through so much dross before you see something entertaining.
Well, if something's presented well, it has the wow factor and people immediately go, wow, and that sets it apart. That's usually because they've put some energy into taking the photo and energy into producing the photo.
Well, this is a truly beautiful book, Ken, and I congratulate you on it, Ken Duncan, Western Australia at its absolute best in that book. And for people who haven't quite mastered all of the techniques that we've been talking about...
That's it. Now, look...
This is the Bible.
There's a very small... We made it small so you can carry it with you. Mm. And both these... This one here, my new book I've done with a great photographer called Steve Fraser, who's an up-and-coming. So I really like promoting the industry, because photography is the number one hobby in Australia. So fishermen, nah.
No, it's interesting, although fishermen, true fishermen would say that theirs is a sport.
Oh, well, they can
I'm
say
sorry,
that.
Ken got you there.
You know
what you should have done? You should have put a bloody camera in here, shouldn't you? You could have had a camera in the book.
A camera?
A cunning little, you know.
A little secret one,
That would have been clever.
You might need that sometimes, too.
Never know, Ken. Thank you so much.
It's been
a pleasure talking to you. Lovely to meet you, man. So the book is out and available.
Stunning book.
This one, how good would it be to be able to take photographs like the ones behind us?
Oh, it has just been beautiful to watch all of that.
And I love the tree.
It's very mystical, isn't it?
Yep.
Fabulous.